Coming up on this summer edition of the Met Report, one former Metro student athlete gets recognition for his accomplishments. Also, Jeffrey Will gives you a quick preview of the next generation of gaming consoles. And MSU Denver hosts some Colorado politicians to discuss immigration. This and more coming up on the Met Report. Welcome to this summer edition of the Met Report. I'm Erik Gallion. For all of you who drive to campus, you might want to consider alternative ways of commuting to and from school. AHEC has implemented yet another increase in parking rates. The 50-cent increase includes all parking lots except those whose daily max is already $6. The $4 in and out lot on the west side of campus is currently under construction, so parking will become scarce when the semester starts up. Keep in mind that you can save a few cents if you decide to carpool and park in places such as the 7th Street parking garage or purchase a parking passport. The fall 2013 graduation application deadline is only 1 month away. If you plan on graduating after this semester, make sure you complete your application before Friday, September 6th. For more information regarding the fall graduation application deadline, visit msudenver.edu/registrar. Many teachers on campus use Blackboard as an extension of the classroom, but it can be confusing. As a result, MSU Denver hosts Blackboard training sessions on August 5th through the 9th. The sessions are 2 hours long and will show students how to navigate through the program. Students will learn how to submit homework, take tests, and send and receive emails. The training is in West Classroom, room 244C. In conjunction with the Coloradans for Citizenship Now Coalition, MSU Denver SGA hosted a luncheon with several influential politicians. The luncheon hosted several members of Congress, such as Ed Perlmutter and Diana DeGette, but the star of the meeting was Gang of Seven Congressman Luis Gutierrez. Met reporter Jake Holgerson was at the press conference afterward.
Supporters for comprehensive immigration reform gathered at a luncheon and public forum at St. Catharine's Cathedral on July 21st. But it was Congressman Luis Gutierrez who the crowd came to see.
We need Carter, we need Johnson, we need other Republicans, but we also need for the Speaker to be the Speaker of the House, to be the Speaker of the American people and not his party.
Gutierrez is referring to the Speaker of the House, Sean Boehner, who enacted the HACER rule before a vote could be passed on any immigration bills a few days earlier.
The Speaker operates under a rule that he wants to have a majority of his caucus in favor of this before he'll bring it to the floor.
I don't see any way of bringing an immigration bill to the floor that doesn't have a majority support of Republicans.
I hope the members of the media understand that what is being said is that a minority of members of the House of Representatives can hold hostage important legislation that will bring relief to our immigrant community. Perlmutter and I didn't go there just to fight. We went there to win. We went there to win. We want to come back and say we've accomplished the goals you sent us to the Congress of the United States to get done.
This is Jake Holgerson for the Met Report.
Infinitas Pi Possibilities is coming to the Tivoli. As its name says it all, iPie has 8-inch pizzas where you can pick from 5 types of crusts, 9 sauces, and 28 toppings. Any combination desired is possible. The grand opening for the new pizzeria is expected to be within the next week. Infinitas Pi is taking the spot left vacant by Pizzarina on the second floor of the Tivoli. Orders can be placed online just 15 minutes before class is over at infinituspie.com or by calling 720-887-4588. But of course, stopping in for always a bite is always welcome. If you're a female student looking to get into the journalism field, then this upcoming student program might be for you. On Monday, August 26th, the Metro Office of Student Activities hosts the first annual Women in Sports Expo. The expo is held to honor Jessica Redfield Gawi, whose life was cut short during the Aurora Theater shooting. Jessica was an aspiring sports journalist pursuing her career here at MSU Denver. The expo will be held in the Tivoli Student Union, starts at 9 a.m., and features panel discussions and workshops with the women in the industry. Jessica's mother, Sandy Phillips, will be the keynote speaker. To register, visit msudenver.edu/studentactivities/wise. Metrosphere, Metro Students Media Arts and Literary Magazine, hosts their first Poetry Slam and are looking for performers. The slam is August 17th at the Tattered Cover Bookstore in Lodo from 7 to 8:30. Email Sal Chris at schrist@msudenver.edu for more information and get your green eggs and slam on. Coming up after the break, MSU Denver's athletic department gets some new upgrades to the basketball court. Plus, we show you what the anticipated 2014 video game releases are. And Washington, D.C. arrests a suspected monument vandal. Jaime Tian, the suspect in the Washington, D.C. National Landmark vandalism case, appeared in court for the first time this past Tuesday. Tian is accused of vandalizing multiple landmarks, including the Lincoln Memorial, with green paint mixed with toxic chemicals, feces, and urine. Damage estimates from all the locations are still being totaled. Authorities confirmed that Tian had a bucket of green paint with her when she was arrested.
Can confirm late this afternoon an arrest was made. The suspect, who appears to have vandalized both Bethlehem Chapel and Children's Chapel here at Washington National Cathedral. The original vandalism was found in Bethlehem Chapel in the lower level, and so we closed the lower level, and then later in the afternoon additional paint had been found in Children's Chapel.
As summer ends, be on the lookout for mosquitoes that could be infected with the West Nile virus. At least four people have been infected with West Nile so far in Colorado this summer, and the numbers are on the rise. Two cases in Larimer County have become seriously ill. West Nile can be deadly even to healthy people. Larimer County Health Department officials offer these tips for protecting yourself outdoors. Use bug repellent that contains DEET, wear long sleeves and pants while outdoors, drain standing water in your yard, and keep your window screens in good repair. West Nile infections have been reported in Larimer, Boulder, and Delta County so far this season. Be safe out there, Metro. The Longmont Humane Society is in danger of closing down due to foreclosure. The $9 million facility is more than $3 million in debt. The facility was built back in 2006 in an effort to expand their operations. The addition has instead drained them of all their money. They have until November 30th to make a loan payment of almost $800,000. If they don't, the complex will be forced to close and more than 350 animals will be placed into other shelters. If you would like to donate, you could go to their website at longmonthumane.org. Innovative Readiness Training, or IRT, provides real-world training opportunities for the Air National Guard while supporting the needs of America's underserved community. The Met Report went to Arizona and New Mexico to watch the Colorado Air National Guard support the Navajo Nation with two IRT projects.
The 140th Civil Engineer Squadron out of Buckley Air Force Base, Colorado, is hard at work. They have two innovative readiness training projects on their plates. One, restoring group homes for families with disabled children for the St. Michael's Association for Special Education Project, or SMACE, in Window Rock, Arizona. The other project, Footprint, calls for their help building modular homes for Navajo veterans and families in Gallup, New Mexico. Footprint is one of four projects in association with the Southwest Indian Foundation, or SWIFT.
The SMACE and SWIFT projects benefit everyone involved in multiple ways. Military units that are TDY here receive real-world hands-on experience, and the Navajo Nation receives new and restored homes, roads, and waterways.
Members from the 140th CE Squadron received help from local workers and the 733rd Engineer Company Army Reserve Unit out of Greenville, Tennessee.
It's a huge honor. St. Michael's is a wonderful organization, and if we can contribute more, I would love to come back and do some more work.
Senior Airman Tyler Simonson says he values the skills he learned on this mission.
I've learned a little bit about the structure side of things. I've learned a little bit about plumbing. I've learned a little bit about electrical work, and hoping to continue that because these are all very good skills and trades to learn on the outside.
And if there's one sentiment everyone's feeling at the SMACE and SWIFT projects, it's the satisfaction of helping out fellow Americans.
It's great to help people on our own soil who need it.
We want to share our experience and provide for the communities as much as we can.
The Steak and Shake corporate office is filing federal lawsuits against two Denver locations in Sheridan and Centennial, claiming both locations are charging too much for their menu items. The corporate office has already ended its agreement with their franchisees, and now it wants the court to shut them down. The two stores claim that all of their prices were approved by the Steak and Shake company and have filed a counterclaim. The two will meet in court this fall. This past year, the Girl Scouts of Colorado made budget cuts of more than $3 million due to lacking cookie sales. The Scouts have also lost one-third of their staff. The lacking sales isn't because the girls aren't selling them. It is simply because there is a shortage of Girl Scouts. The Scouts have seen a 20% decline in active members over the last 10 years. The Girl Scouts are asking parents and other volunteers to help out as much as they can to help reduce budget cuts. Coming up after the break, Kevin Hall shows you the progress that has been made to the new sports fields, and Jeffrey Will tells you what new hardware is around the corner in the gaming world.
Now and then I get insecure from all the pain. I'm so ashamed. I am beautiful no matter what.
Where I bring Hollywood a mile high.
Aligning the Hollywood stars over Denver.
I'm here to bring you the latest juicy gossip from the mile high to the streets of Hollywood.
Give your most handsome look to that camera.
Where I'll be bringing you the latest gossip from Tinseltown all the way up to a mile high.
I didn't get any injuries. I was okay. I was a little dancing.
Check us out every Friday live at 12:30 p.m. on The Met Report.
Hi guys, this is Eddie McClintock. I play Special Agent Pete Latimer on Warehouse 13, and you are watching The Met Report.
Now joining us for entertainment with some gaming news is Jeffrey Will. What's happening, Jeff?
Thanks, Eric. Hey Metro, Jeffrey Will here with all the gaming news and highlights from E3. First up, we take a look at Microsoft's Xbox One. At the reveal, which took place a few weeks before E3, Microsoft displayed the Xbox One's seamless transitions from game to live television to movie with no wait time or closing of current running programs. They even showed off the new Snap Mode, allowing the player to pull up the internet or Skype with a simple voice command. Back at E3, Microsoft reps displayed the system's capability with smart glass devices for gameplay and other Xbox One functions. The system originally required a 24-hour internet access and game restrictions such as no trading in games to retailers and no lending or selling of games to friends. This didn't fly too well with fans. Microsoft announced last June that they changed the Xbox One to allow used and borrowed games, as well as the system no longer requires being online. The system's retail price is $499 and is expected to launch in November of this year. Now let's switch gears to the Sony's reveal of the PlayStation 4. Sleek design and new features. PlayStation 4 will be coming with new music and video applications. Sony also announced that in 2014, a cloud-based library of critically acclaimed PS3 games will be available for PS3 and 4 consoles, as well as the Vita. Sony then not only took one but three low blows at Microsoft. First Shot received a roaring response from the crowd about the PlayStation 4 allowing used and borrowed games to be played on the console. Shot number two, the system does not require being on the internet for gameplay or periodic online check-ins. And the third, the retail price of the PS4 is $399, $100 cheaper than the Xbox One. There is no confirmed release date, but is expected to launch late in the holiday season this year. Though many are excited for the next generation of gaming systems, all the current systems still have plenty of games guaranteed to leave their mark before the holiday season. First, we look at the third installment to the Arkham series, Batman Arkham Origins. Black Mask has placed a $50 million bounty on the Dark Knight, and every known assassin wants it. Batman Arkham Origins hits the shelves on October 25th. Saints Row 4 is coming out August 20th. Aliens have invaded, which opens a whole new can of worms for the Saints universe. Fight the alien menace back with new weapons, including a laser sword and new superpowers. Nintendo remakes a classic for the Wii U system. Legend of Zelda: The Wind Waker has been remastered and new features have been added to match the capabilities of the Wii U console. Check out The Legend of Zelda: The Wind Waker HD coming in stores in October. Also in October for the 3DS, the worldwide release of Pokemon X and Y introduces the Kalos region along with a completely new Pokemon type, Fairy type. Let's not forget all the new Pokemon you'll meet in this new adventure. Now here's a quick look at what's expected to come in 2014. Take a look.
Gain the offensive.
Well, that happens sometimes.
So is there a chance I can play my PS3 games on these new gaming systems?
Unfortunately, no. They just recently announced that all Xbox One and PS4 consoles will not be backwards compatible with PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. However, both respective stores will be having digital downloads of previous generation games available for purchase. So if you want to keep your old favorites, hang on to your old systems. It'll make things a lot easier.
I want to play Nintendo games on PS3.
That's a franchise problem.
All right, thank you so much, Jeff. All right, well, after the break, a former MSU Denver student athlete earns a prestigious award.
On that long and do it all again so I can find my way back home.
The sun seems to shine a little less since you've been gone.
You were the one I wanted.
Don't stray, don't ever go away.
I'll just smile and everyone will wanna go with it. Oh.
From the Colorado School of Mines in Golden.
To Black Hills State University in South Dakota.
To Colorado State University in Pueblo.
For more than 100 years.
The Rocky Mountain Athletic Conference
has stood for excellence in the classroom and on the playing field.
With 14 great colleges and universities.
Student athletes in the RMAC achieve on a national stage.
While earning their college degrees.
The Rocky Mountain Athletic Conference continuing the tradition of excellence.
Now joining us for Roadrunner Sports is Kevin Hall. Kevin, the new athletic fields look like they're coming together nicely.
Recently, the RMAC had their Hall of Fame induction ceremony, and former Metro State basketball star Mark Worthington was one of those inducted. Worthington, a four-year player and national champion, was one of 10 inductees this past weekend, and he joins a plethora of former Roadrunners, including his former coach Mike Dunlap, who was inducted a few years ago. Worthington spoke on joining the Hall and his time here at Metro.
Anyone who did 4 years under Coach Dunlap probably deserves an award. But that's the sort of person and the expectations he had on us as humans. He didn't want us just to be great basketball players or in a great team. He wanted us to be great human beings. And I think over the course of 4 years, a lot of people molded from boys to men, and a lot of them great men.
Metro State now has one less coaching vacancy, as Daniel Hangsteffer was named the new tennis coach this past month. Hangsteffer was previously the assistant coach at Midwestern State University in Wichita Falls, Texas, where he was named the Intercollegiate Tennis Association South Central Region Men's Assistant Coach of the Year in 2013. During his time in the Lone Star State, he helped the Mustangs win the Lone Star Conference, the NCAA Regional Tournament, earning a trip to the Elite Eight. He helped the women's team advance to the Sweet 16 after also winning the regional title, helping both squads to the top 20 national ranking. Hangsteffer replaces 12-year tennis veteran Beck Mears, who decided to leave for a coaching position to coach in her native land of Australia. We have a couple updates from the construction of the multi-million dollar athletic fields that have been started earlier this year. The complex set just south side of Colfax is starting to take shape. The tennis teams got a small glimpse of their new courts as the courts are nearly done. Lights have been installed so matches can take place under the stars, and the finished surface is being laid down to give the courts a nice crisp look. Hope is to have the tennis courts finished by the start of the fall sports season. The area where the soccer field is going to go have been leveled and smoothed out and are getting prepared to lay down a synthetic grass that many schools are turning to. Along with the tennis teams, the new complex will be the home for both men's and women's soccer, baseball, and softball. From construction outside to construction inside, the school is putting the finishing touches on an upgraded gym for our volleyball and basketball teams. The M-Bird in the middle of the floor is no more and has been replaced by the school's new updated logo, and the school's name has been placed along the sidelines where the team's benches are placed. A dark blue border surrounds the floor with the word Roadrunners lining the baseline under both baskets. The gym is set to reopen within the next week. Now, in addition to the new floors, we're also getting new scoreboards that were donated from the Pepsi Center, so things are starting to really look good in that gym.
Have you gotten a chance to play on the new gym floor yet?
Not yet. Gym is still closed, trying to let everything dry and get settled in. But once it opens, you can bet I'll be there.
Oh, definitely. All right. Thank you so much, Kevin. Well, that's going to do it for this week's edition of the Met Report. For Jeffrey Will, Kevin Hall, and the whole Met Report staff, I'm Erik Gallion. Enjoy the rest of your summer, Metro.